la conferencia.
Thank you very much. I am the chief election, former chief election commissioner of India, and I have seen elections from the closest quarter. My own conclusion from this conference and the earlier conference is that the election is not just one of the end all and be all of democracy. It is one of the components of democracy, but perhaps the most critical and important component. Second conclusion, which is very clear from all the deliberations, that corruption in election is very widespread. It's an international phenomenon. And the root cause of all corruption is the experience in election. Rest follows. Therefore, role of money power becomes the most critical issue. And if we have to clean up the system, we have to make sure that elections are cleaned up, and for which we have to strengthen the election commission. I have said that I go back with a mixed feeling. One is the consolation that we thought we are India, the election commission is considered the most powerful commission in the world, but we accept that we are afraid against money power. But to see that all others are also struggling with the same problem is a bit of a consolation, if you may say so. At the same time, there is a disappointment that why did the solution has been eluding us all these years. I have come to a positive conclusion out of that. The fact that all of us are in the same boat, probably we will now find a solution faster than we have thought. This conference has shown us lots of success stories, lots of models from which we can draw. What we need, conclude that we need good laws, we need effective implementation, and surely we need powerful election commission. I am very happy to say that this year the international ideas focus has been to find a solution. This is the second in a series of three conferences, and a blueprint for the action is emerging surely and clearly. One conclusion which I draw from all these deliberations is that we have to enlarge the catchment area for our deliberations. Right now it has only been academics or maybe some election managers who have been discussing these issues and some kind of civil society. But we probably need to bring in more of media, because they play a very important role in policy formulation. They have become the biggest pressure group. And also we should bring in the judiciary. As we have seen, judiciary has been playing a very important role in the electoral reform where the parliament has been failing us. From the four the group reports, I find that there is at least one thing which appealed to me most. First, the group talked about the lack of gender equality. I'm very happy to say that for gender equality, we don't necessarily have to depend on law. There are many things we can do ourselves. But in the election commission did three things which have turned out to be historic. First, we started monitoring the electoral roll to see whether genders are equally represented. When we started 5 years ago, we were abysmal. And now we have brought the gender gap to almost zero. Secondly, voter education. We were targeted women, and in half of Indian states, women outnumbered men as voters, although their absolute numbers are smaller. And third, one of the contributory administrative measures we did was that when they come to the vote, there are long queues. Now, women have a lot of work to do at home. They find it very difficult to spend hours away from home. We say for every man who goes inside the polling booth, allowed to women. As a result, the women's queues were disappeared very fast. And then they were sending all other neighbors to come and vote. It worked very well. Then the second group talked about involving stakeholders, because if they are involved,
it would have been that we wait for them to make a mistake and pounce on them. We said, no, that's not what we want. That's the last thing we would like to do. We would like to prevent it. So we called them over. We explained our new reforms and guidelines. and they showed a lot of positive interest. Third group is stressed on civic education. Again, we had a very interesting experience in India. 5 years ago, when we mooted the idea of civic education, voter education, we were criticized by our own colleagues. They said, educating voters is not your job. Your job is to conduct elections. But I said, nothing doing. Because when there is voter apathy, turnout is only 25%, the legitimacy of the representatives is questioned. Then people talk of drastic measures like compulsory voting. All these are not acceptable. So we found civic education is a very, very powerful tool, and which will happen if we involve more stakeholders like academics and media and others. And finally, although I've touched upon this earlier, sanctions versus motivation. One great example of the motivation is Indian example, where political parties themselves have come up with a model code of conduct. It is not a law, but compliance to the model code of conduct is better than any law of the land. And what is the model code? We will not disturb each other's meeting, no rebel rousing, no caste and communal appeal, no hate speech, no abuse of state authority. In fact, we have seen that the ruling party starts hating us before long because we do not allow them to abuse their authority. We transfer the officers whom they appoint to influence elections. So model code is a thing which shows that there are possibilities beyond legislation also. And I think in the end, I feel that election management bodies should be include more and more. And finally, sir, I would like to mention that international support, there are many upcoming or international or the bodies of election management bodies. For instance, we have South Asian FEMBOSA, we have an Asian Election Association of Election Authorities, we have GEO, we have AWEB. I think you need to work a little more closely. You can provide technical support, you can give input, you can do a lot more hand-holding, because they're coming together and for experience sharing will prove to be very effective. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kurashi, and I would like to invite Obi to give her view.
Thank you very much. I am very delighted to be able to give some perspective from the angle of civil society. And the first thing that I would like to do is to state clearly that there is a necessity to expand this conversation. To expand this conversation in a way that enables us to set a global public agenda for this conversation beyond the community of experts in elections and activities connected to political systems. So the first thing for me is political and economic reforms need to now go hand in hand. We need to be able to have the political scientists push the necessity for economists as collaborators in recognizing that today's global economic inequality is being driven by the seizure of the political space by the few global elite that have the capacity to influence politics across nations. And so one major thing that I would hope that international idea and collaborators would do is to launch the process of a global study on the effect of political money in politics on the global economic inequality. There's got to be a study that pushes everyone to an understanding that this phenomenon is not compartmentalized at all. And then the second point is that for citizens who do not immediately consider this an issue, it is because they are distant from the process of money in politics. And so as we look at reviewing the various options for financing political parties and candidates, is it possible to begin to look at options that would make citizens feel they are investors in the process and therefore be more willing and be more involved in the kind of scrutiny that would enable the better regulation of existing systems that have been proposed and not operating at par. And then part of that, as the number three, is that putting the citizens at the center of this conversation will require much more than moral suasion. So how about a shock therapy? A shock therapy in the sense of being able to show to citizens the direct effect of either illicit money or even corporate business money in their politics. How the purchase of policies and the purchase of spending priorities of government lead to poverty and impoverishment. So it is important, as I propose, that perhaps one of the things to do would be to follow the model of Transparency International. How about a ranking of countries in terms of their money in politics score? Is it possible to assemble a group of eggheads that can think of how to analyze the situation in various countries and to come up with a ranking that would shock not only the citizens but also the actors in the political space into the necessary action that needs to be taken? And then I said the exclusionary number five for me, the exclusionary impact of money in politics on women can be used as an entry point to capture a huge population of citizens that are interested in this topic. That catchment might actually become the best collaborators that we have to move this agenda forward. And then the sixth one is the role of technology. I said, today's world is a world of collaborative partnership. It is time for IDEA to take its war to the globe, to the industry, to take its partnership to the technology industry, and to see how, in a deliberate and intentional way, especially in jurisdictions that are weaker, the kinds of systems that would enable them do this more effectively and more efficiently can begin to be developed. And then the seventh one is the role that international IDEA can play in strengthening the capacity of independent electoral commissions across the world, especially in weaker jurisdictions. Is it possible to have regional kinds of standards that different regions would commit to working toward? Is it possible to do that? Because sometimes we have seen that regional mechanisms have a way of forcing domestic reform. And then I think this is my final point, and I will shut up. I said that especially with as it concerns the matter of abuse of state resources, abuse of state institutions, I said this calls attention to the fact that we're discussing a broader governance agenda. And so ensuring that we're not isolating this problem from the broader necessity to consistently push an agenda for improvement in good governance across countries is going to be important, so that we're not insular in the way that we're trying to tackle a problem that is a manifestation of broken governance across countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very, very much for bringing the voice from civil society with these very good ideas, and also for creating the connection when you address the issue of the relevance of the work of regional organization. And now I will ask Francisco Guerrero from the Organization of American States to address precisely this issue. Francisco.
Muchas gracias por la oportunidad de hacer algunos comentarios. Después de escuchar a quienes han hecho una síntesis tan apretada pero tan importante de lo que se ha discutido durante estos días, Yo quisiera hacer una suerte de reflexión general desde la óptica de cómo se ven este tipo de asuntos en una organización regional, en este caso la Organización de los Estados Americanos. Creo que es necesario, con todos estos elementos, tratar de construir lo que yo llamaría un círculo virtuoso. ¿Y a qué me refiero con un círculo virtuoso? ¿Cómo podemos encontrar la preocupación y las necesidades que la sociedad civil está manifestando, no solo en América, sino en muchos otros continentes, en contra de la corrupción y el dinero sucio en las campañas, con buena legislación y con voluntad política por parte de los gobiernos para enfrentar lo que yo llamaría un cáncer de la democracia? Si el dinero sucio o el dinero de los negocios entra a la política y corrompe la legitimidad de los gobernantes, estamos teniendo procesos electorales que a pesar de ser caros, que a pesar de ser complejos, no están dando los resultados que todos quisiéramos. Por eso me voy a permitir hacer 6 reflexiones muy puntuales que me parece pueden ser útiles. La primera, no hay sustituto a una buena legislación. Sé que estamos un poco desesperados, sobre todo en esta región, porque tenemos buenas leyes, pero no se aplican suficientemente bien. Sin embargo, hay todavía países donde ni siquiera tenemos buenas leyes. Y tener buenas leyes es el primer inicio. En ese sentido, yo he escuchado comentarios en torno a la necesidad de que los grupos legislativos, de que los partidos políticos escuchen este clamor social y pongan sobre la mesa buenas legislaciones. Por supuesto, la buena legislación tiene que venir acompañada de la voluntad política. Está en aras de la supervivencia del modelo electoral y de la democracia que los políticos entiendan que si no corresponden a este clamor popular, la gobernabilidad se pone en peligro, pero además los riesgos de que socialmente la gente salga a las calles y no sea a través de las elecciones, sino de otro tipo de mecanismos, como se ejerza presión, suceda. Segundo, y Kevin Casas lo señaló con mucha claridad, yo coincido con él, se necesitan metas realistas. No se trata de hacer un catálogo de buenas intenciones, sino sobre todo aquellos que hemos participado en la organización de elecciones, sabemos que el que organiza elecciones tiene ciertos límites y es muy difícil desafiar esos límites si no se cuenta con esta conciencia de que las metas tienen que ser realistas. Se decía que el contexto cuenta, por supuesto que cuenta, y estamos viendo en muchas regiones del mundo que en base a este contexto difícil de desconfianza hacia los partidos políticos y hacia el propio sistema electoral, empiezan a surgir voces que bajo una agenda populista quieren poner soluciones que no están conectadas con la realidad. Un tercer elemento con el que, y Kevin me comprenderá muy bien porque él ha estado en mis zapatos, cómo lograr la apertura de los estados nacionales ante las recomendaciones de los organismos internacionales. El diagnóstico está claro. En cada misión, por eso hay algunos países que luego no se sienten tan cómodos con la observación electoral. ¿Por qué? Porque en las resoluciones que damos en los informes técnicos viene con toda claridad qué no está funcionando y vienen recomendaciones específicas de qué debe modificarse. Pero aquí se requiere, y aquí creo que la sociedad civil juega un papel central, que la presión de los organismos de la sociedad civil orilla a los gobiernos a comprender que si no se toman reformas estructurales en materia de fiscalización, de control del dinero y de acceso a rendición de cuentas en los estados nacionales, será difícil avanzar en esta materia. Se ha mencionado, y yo coincido, el uso de la tecnología al servicio de la rendición de cuentas y la transparencia. Si ya todos los ciudadanos tenemos a través de nuestro teléfono inteligente un mecanismo para ser testigos y denunciantes de los actos de corrupción, de impunidad, de abuso de poder, no veo por qué no utilicemos más estos medios a través de los organismos públicos para poder empujar esta agenda. Creo también, y esto es importante, que se deben tomar con seriedad los modelos que han sido exitosos. Se señalaba en el caso de América Latina, el caso de Costa Rica, el caso de México, donde por lo menos se ha hecho un esfuerzo por profundizar los mecanismos de financiamiento y tener lo que se llama, por ejemplo, la contabilidad en línea. Yo siempre me he preguntado si los ciudadanos podemos saber día con día cuánto gastamos en nuestra tarjeta de crédito y lo contrastamos contra una tarjeta de débito y el sueldo que recibimos, y tenemos ingresos y egresos, ¿por qué esto no se puede hacer en el control del financiamiento de los partidos políticos? Yo creo que sí se puede hacer y hay que caminar en esa dirección. Y finalmente una reflexión ya más de índole política y como ciudadano. Creo que esfuerzos como el que hace IDEA deben ser apoyados por todos los organismos. Ya Daniel Sobato y yo hemos estado platicando cómo construiremos una agenda el año próximo con la OEA a efecto de poder caminar en este sentido. Creo que está en el interés de todos que el narcotráfico, los grupos de interés y los intereses inconfesables no sean los que determinen el resultado de las elecciones y que sigamos siendo los ciudadanos los que con el ejercicio libre y soberano de nuestro voto decidamos quién va a tener las riendas de los órganos representativos. Ceder ante la presión de que sea el dinero mal habido el que determine la ruta de la política, creo que sería una cuestión muy lamentable. No debemos permitir que estos grupos ilegítimos roben de los ciudadanos el poder de elegir. Creo que eso es muy importante. Y termino diciendo que al final del día, de lo que se trata y de lo que se trata siempre, es cómo mantenemos la confianza de los ciudadanos en las elecciones. Es decir, que vale la pena ir a votar y que ese voto que estamos emitiendo como ciudadanos se corresponde con elecciones bien hechas, bien vigiladas y que los recursos económicos sean vigilados adecuadamente. Así que yo felicito en particular la organización de este evento. Siempre es un privilegio participar con IDEA y con los demás organismos, en el caso de los de mi país, del INE y del Tribunal Electoral, y creo que tenemos que continuar en este esfuerzo y hoy hemos dado un gran paso porque tenemos una agenda clara de lo que hay que hacer, ahora solo hay que acompañarlo de voluntad política por parte de los estados nacionales, de los legisladores, a efecto de caminar en una buena dirección. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias a los tres panelistas. La verdad que sus respectivos enfoques desde los organismos electorales, desde la sociedad civil y particularmente de los organismos regionales, un tema que ha estado muy presente en las deliberaciones, cómo bajar este tema de una discusión global con la perspectiva de las diferentes regiones. Queremos dar la oportunidad y le agradecemos obviamente la paciencia con que han escuchado ustedes las siete intervenciones previas, si quieren hacer algunos comentarios, no más de tres o cuatro comentarios breves, y si no pasaríamos directamente a las palabras de clausura. Preferiría que no fueran preguntas, sino algún comentario o alguna reflexión muy puntual, vuelvo a insistir, con el mayor gusto. Por favor.
First of all, I must say that it has been a wonderful experience being here, educative, learning and so on. Listening to the entire deliberations and even the closing comments, there has been talk of the larger ecosystem. We are talking of money in politics, the most visible manifestation of which are the elections. The single most important player in elections are political parties. Based on my experience and information that I have, political parties are supposedly the pillars of democracy, but they are not internally democratic. There are laws in some countries, and in some countries there are no laws. How well are they implemented is another question. I think the trying to tackle the problem of money in politics alone without worrying about the larger ecosystem is like counting trees and not looking at the forest. I think it is absolutely essential, based on my experience of 15 years in this arena, that unless there is attempt to make political parties internally democratic. Political parties listen to citizens and voters once in 5 years or once in 6 years, but they would have to listen to their members every day. You know, that I think is the single most reform that is needed in political governance and in the larger governance which OB mentioned. Unless political parties are made to be reasonably democratic, demonstrably and verifiably democratic, As I said in the last session that I was part of, that democracy obviously can never be perfect. It is, democracy is a journey, not a destination. But political parties in several parts of the world have not even started on that journey. We need to get political parties get on the bus of democracy. They create democracy for the world, but they don't do it for themselves. This is totally anomalous and it is not acceptable. We must do that to the extent we can. Thank you.
Muchísimas gracias a usted. ¿Algún otro comentario? Bueno, razonablemente están cansados, me imagino, y con ganas de escuchar ya las reflexiones finales. Así que invito al secretario general de IDEA a que haga su comentario final de clausura.
Thank you very much, Daniel. Ladies and gentlemen, I assume that I am the last obstacle between now and your well-deserved weekend. So that's a motivation to be very brief. We've come at the end of our global conference, and on behalf of International IDEA, I would like to say that I consider it as a success. It is, I think, indeed, for our institution, a very important landmark in a already long-lasting history of work, interaction with the theme of money and politics, the negative roles played by money and politics, but also the need for equal access to money and the position, for instance, of women in that domain. 18 years ago, Tanya told me, 18 years ago already in Stockholm, there were meetings about that issue. A couple of years after, there was the publication of the first edition of the handbook on money and politics, and recently, I think 1 year ago or 6 months ago, we published a new version that is now available in Spanish, thanks to the good cooperation with the people here. And we started a series of conferences. Together with the colleagues of the OECD, my former colleagues even, we organized a very important START meeting in Paris. Since then, thanks to the efforts of Minister Diaz-Toffoli, we had a very important meeting in Brasilia. And today we close our global conference here in Mexico. I think these events have been very productive. And during these 2.5 days here in Mexico, we gathered more than 150 specialists from all over the globe, which is, as such, I think, already a very important and remarkable achievement. But of course, more importantly, I think that we clearly reached our objectives in terms of the very rich content of the debates and discussions. Remember 2.5 days ago at the museum, we put forward three objectives. We said we wanted to work solutions-oriented, not only make the analysis of how bad things are to a certain extent, but seize the opportunity of this platform to discuss solutions and best practices. I think this has been the case. Number two, we want within the community of practitioners in this field, we wanted to have a good debate, a good talk about the possible gaps in the approach we have as an international community of that problem. I think we succeeded to reach that objective. For instance, yesterday, I think the meeting, the special meeting that was organized by the colleagues of that community of practitioners, gave the opportunity to exchange our views on where we are in terms of the research agenda and to see how we can fill the gap. Third objective was to seize opportunities to coordinate. We're all working with scarce resources, and it is very important in terms of the possibility to make progress that we agree amongst ourselves about a certain distribution of labor. So I think we reached these objectives. And this gives the feeling that notwithstanding the fact that 2025, 18 years ago after that first meeting, since lots of decades, the problem exists, and it is still a very important problem, the capture of the political agenda by vested interests, the negative role played by legal, illicit money. But on the other hand, I think the feeling you have after 2.5 days of exchange with you is that there are solutions, that it depends on maybe efficient work by us, but also, of course, more importantly, it depends on the political will of the people outside this room. Ladies and gentlemen, this global conference is not an end point. It is one of these very important landmarks. But I would briefly like to at least point out 4 to 5 elements of what I would call the way ahead. Number one, and this is from a very practical point of view, and thanks to the work of Kevin Casas, we will try to circulate for the end of the month, September, comprehensive overview, not in detail, but an overview of the debates, conclusions oriented, and we will invite all participants to react on that summary, to enrich it also with maybe things you have been thinking about since the meeting. Number two, we have to work further on the discussion yesterday evening, that community of practitioners of practice, where we decided to exchange information, to keep ourselves mutually informed about initiatives we take. You all represent very active institutions, organizations in this field, and I think we can create lots of win-win situations. So IDEA will take up the responsibility under the leadership of Sam and the colleagues to, for the first period, to be the anchor of that community of practitioners, of practice, by exchange of mails, by informing each other. That's the second element of the way ahead. Number three, very importantly, and I thank Mr. Swain for the conversation, Director Swain for the conversation this morning, we agreed upon the content and the structure of the next global conference, normally the last one for that is already planned in New Delhi. Normally it will take place in the course of the month December, and we decided on the agenda more or less. I won't enter into detail. I want to stick to my promise. I'm a former politician, but I know sometimes it is important to stick to your promises. But one thing is very important is that we will try to continue to make